Good morning.
Now I'm going to start this different. Good morning, saints.
Good morning.
Good morning, sinners.
Good morning.
Yeah, the last response was louder, I thought so. Welcome to Bon Aqua United Methodist Church for a combined worship service. We have all four of our churches together, and we are so blessed to have our associate district superintendent, Stephen Handy. And some of you have asked me, what is the urban cohort district? And how do we qualify as urban in Hickman County? And we've talked about that being centralized, but Stephen is our district superintendent over that small experimental group, and he'll address that more a little bit later. I want to give you Stephen's bio before we get started, and I'm going to do this. I'm going to read this straight from what was on the conference website.
Please don't.
Hey, it's on the internet. It's got to be true. It's on the internet. Stephen is the lead pastor visionary strategist, get this, and partnership collaborator of the gospel message of Jesus Christ at McHenry United Methodist Church, which is in downtown Nashville. It's a passionate communicator, and I'm going to add a phenomenal communicator, that desires to speak God's truth so people of different cultures, experiences, neighborhoods, and all of God's unique diversity can be reconciled through the unity in Jesus Christ. Stephen is a strong advocate of restorative justice, serving the poor and needy, and participating in life groups for spiritual formation and accountability. Stephen and his wife Shelley are married, that's a good thing, with three children and live in the greater Nashville area, and his go-to scripture is Philippians 4:13, do all things through Christ. We have a few announcements that I want to share with you this morning. They've been scrolling through on the screens. Just a couple that I want to highlight. This afternoon at 4 o'clock at Franklin First United Methodist Church, there will be an opportunity to meet with our new Harpeth River District Superintendent, B.J. Brack, and Bishop McAlilly will be giving the message, the address there, and this will be one of his last opportunities to speak to the district as he retires this month. So you are invited to come to that if you want to. Rhonda?
Yeah.
Rhonda.
Yes.
Women's Bible study.
It's great. It's fabulous. We're not meeting this week.
I'm going to be
in Fort Smith, Arkansas.
Okay.
So, but we will meet next Thursday. I really would love for some of the rest of you to come. We're studying, I think you saw as it went around, Discerning the Voice of God. It's a Priscilla Shirer. If you've done any of her studies, you know she is amazing. And we've been in, 3 weeks now? And we finished day one this week.
That's good. Yes. That's right up there with Elijah.
Yes, right. It is.
Elijah.
It's going to be neck and neck.
Elijah was, a six-week study?
Mm-hmm.
It took 2.5 years.
Yeah. Okay. Now, you're getting a little long in the tooth there, Mr. Yeah, it took a long time.
Recharge Wednesday, our midweek recharge opportunity, meets at East Hickman on Wednesday evening at 6:30. We invite you to come to that. The response has been really amazing. We've been averaging between probably 30 and 40 people each Wednesday. But this week, we're going to do something a little different. We're going to talk about The Chosen. Many of you have seen the videos series that's been going on for a couple of years now, 2 or 3 years. And there's a Bible study that we're going to be starting later on, probably in late September or October. And I want us to gather and talk about which one we want to do. They come in different lengths. They come in different options of what we can do. So I want I want you to decide which one we want to do and what direction we want to go with that. So we'll be meeting on Wednesday evening at 6:30 at East Hickman for our Green Charge Wednesday. Walk to Emmaus. You've heard a lot about the Walk to Emmaus. We will be having the men's walk beginning October 3rd and ending on the 6th. The women's walk will be the 17th through the 20th. Jane, is there anything you want to say about the Walk to Emmaus?
Just that I think Jim and I both have said to y'all, it's the most life-changing thing I've ever done. God meets you where you are, wherever that is. and it's different for all of us. So I highly, I guess, recommend that you talk to us about it and prayerfully consider having this weekend experience that is just for you, where you don't have to think about anything. It is just you are taken care of, so you can focus on your walk.
We had one several years ago where one of the people that we sponsored forgot his shoes. So his shoes were delivered to him. So if you have been through the Walk to Emmaus, would you raise your hand? Okay, so we've got three of us here this morning, four of us, five of us here this morning. If you want to have more information, just let us know and we will make sure that we find a sponsor and that your way is taken care of. Just to rehash a little bit, we did pack our backpacks. Those are being distributed now. If you know of a student that needs to have a backpack filled with supplies, let me know and we'll make sure that those are made available to you. We probably still have about 25 left. So if you know of anybody that needs a backpack, just let us know and we'll take care of that. Are there other announcements that you want to share this morning? If not, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Stand as you're able and join in our opening hymn. Now these hymns tie very directly into Stephen's message that we're going to play. So listen to the words as you sing the songs. Lyrics will be on the screen or you can use your hymn on page 530.
Amazing, heavenly, all.
joys and our concerns, those God sightings that we have. I want to let you know that we've restocked the crosses, the hand crosses in the back, so if you need to take some, please feel free to do so to pass out. We know that Bill and Debbie DePaul are not with us today. They are on their way or attending a funeral for family this week, as are Rick and Kathleen. Rick and Kathleen are traveling this morning. His mother passed away, and their services are this week. So keep Rick and Kathleen and Bill and Debbie in your prayers. I don't want to say a matriarch, but an icon, Sally Hudson, was in the hospital this week, and Sally saw her yesterday morning, and she was in good spirits. She got to go home yesterday afternoon, so keep Sally in your prayers. I know that Marilyn spoke with her and
today.
And
she says hi to everybody.
She says hi, and Sally is herself. So we also have, I know that we've talked at Nunley about Brian Buttry's dad being in the hospital. I visited him this week, and his spirits are good. Unfortunately, there is COVID going around again, so there's a lot of isolation and precautions going on. So if you do happen to go to a hospital or to a nursing home to visit with somebody, take the precaution and wear a mask for your safety and for theirs. Are there other joys and concerns that you want to bring up this morning? God sightings?
Beautiful weather.
Beautiful weather. Exactly. You can step outside and not have to drink fresh air. It's a good day. Courtney, how are you doing?
Doing good. Everything looks like it's healing up the way it's supposed to. I'm not weight bearing until the end of the month. And then at the end of the month, hopefully I'll just have to wear a boot and kind of just take it easy. But right now, if that thing hits the floor,
Courtney had a broken leg when she was being a caregiver. Fell off the porch and broke your leg. So we are glad to have you with us this morning and hope that you continue to heal. Are there others?
Two. One is unnamed, and the second for all of those who are feeling overwhelmed.
Well, that encompasses a lot. So unnamed, and then also for those that are overwhelmed with everything. We know that school started this week, so we have a lot of teachers that are overwhelmed and a lot of students that are still trying to figure out which room to go to and when to get there. And there's just a lot going on. We need to keep in our prayers. There was a plane crash there were, I believe, 90 people perished this week. We've got the situation in Israel and Gaza. There are just a lot of things going on in this world, and we just need to keep all of it in our prayers for peace and for reconciliation in so many different ways. Are there others? If not, I invite you to join me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, who saw fit to create all of us, we ask that you make your presence known with us this morning, that you fill our hearts with your spirit, that you clear our minds and allow us to hear the message that you send. We ask travel blessings and mercies on those of our church family that are traveling, and especially for the loss that they've experienced. We ask that you guide them through their grief process, and that you allow them to know that you are with them and that they can make it through this, but they don't have to do it alone. We ask this morning your blessing on the leaders of our country, that calm minds, you clear hearts, help direct decisions that are made. We know that we have a world of conflict right now. We have a world that is struggling. But we know that there is an opportunity if people will just open their eyes and their ears and listen. Listen to those around them. Listen to those that they come from different places, those that come from different languages, those that may be considered outcasts to them. We are all your children, and we ask that you keep us mindful of that, especially during conflict. We know not only is there conflict in the world, but there's conflict within ourselves, within our families, and within our neighborhoods and our communities. Help us calm that. Help us be the light that sheds a little brightness in dark places, those places where no one wants to go, where no one feels welcomed. Just open us up. Help us to have the strength. Help us to have the fortitude. And help us to be guided into those places that are dark, those places of the prisons and the hospitals and the nursing homes and those communities that are disrupted. Help us to be that light. Gracious God, this morning we ask that the prayers that we pray of intercession and petition, the songs that we sing to glorify you, and the message that we hear be done solely for the purpose of glorifying you, that you put us behind the screen, that you put us behind your shadow, and help when people see us that all they see is you, and that all that we do be done to glorify you. We ask this in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. That is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm calling an audible this morning because I sent Rick the wrong information for the scripture. So the scripture that's printed in the bulletin from Acts 2 is not what we're going to be using. But we will be using Acts 1, chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. Hear the word. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, It is not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my spirit witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. This is the word of God for you, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand as you're able and join as we lift our Apostles' Creed. And I want to remind you that this was not what the apostles wrote, but this is for apostles. It's a creed for us to reaffirm our own commitment.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
be seated, and our ushers come forward to receive our morning gifts and offerings. Resources. And we ask now that as we return to you a portion of what you've loaned to us, that you give us the wisdom, the strength, and the direction to use these gifts to further your kingdom, not only in this community, but throughout all your creation. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. To be seated, please. This morning, we have an opportunity to hear the message that Stephen presented at the opening session on the Monday morning of annual conference this year. And after he was done, Janetta and Ross and Jane and I were talking, said, wouldn't it be great if everybody could hear this, because it was so powerful. So I talked with Stephen, and we made arrangements to be able to play the video for you. And then Stephen's going to be available to talk with us a little bit and just have some discussion. So I just ask that as we play this and you hear this message, remember there were probably 1,500 people, and all of them were on their feet by the end. You don't have to get up. We don't have to do that. But I do want you to hear the message.
Happy people of God. I am glad to see you. I didn't sleep last night for obvious reasons. To our beloved Bishop William T. Lapp for inviting me to this momentous occasion, and to our beloved cabinet who affirmed this decision. To the TWK delegates here in Murfreesboro, also known as the Borough, I am grateful to bring a few words today. Let us pray. O loving and liberating God, we give you thanks and praise for another day's journey, another day above ground. We thank you for the breath that we breathe, the same breath that resurrected Jesus from the grave. We're in awe, O God, of what you do and what you say, and sometimes we don't want to go. So we ask if you would be patient with us. Give us insight and perspective. Give us a risk-taking attitude. Don't allow us to get too comfortable with this thing called the gospel. but move us into the frontier, into the uncertainty moments of our day, and have the audacity to put people in our path that will disrupt our understanding of your humanity. God, you are more than enough. Now, tuck me behind your cross, though no one gets confused about who's proclaiming this good news. This is never about us, has never been about us, will never be about us. This is all about you, God. And for that, through Jesus and the presence of the Holy Spirit, we say thank you, amen, and praise the Lord. Would you do me a favor and give the Lord a hand clap of praise, even if you've never done it before? I had a mother who used to tell me this story. And it annoyed me, but I didn't let her know it annoyed me. And she would tell this story of my first day at kindergarten. And I don't remember it, but she would always tell people in the midst of a gathering where she felt I wasn't moving fast enough. She would say on that first day, she had prepped me to go to kindergarten. And so that first day we go in and she's holding my hand and I'm so excited to have all these other kids around. But here's what she didn't tell me. She didn't tell me I was going to stay all day. She was about to walk out the door and I followed her and she said, oh no, you're staying here. I said, oh no, I'm not. I don't know anybody here. What do you mean I'm staying? She says, no, baby, I prepared you for this day. And she said, the teacher said, I cried all day long. I didn't have any tears left in my tear duct. I'm not sure that's true, but that's her story. I remember not liking to be there, and it wasn't because I didn't like the environment. It was simply because my mama wasn't there. I love me some mama. Mama gave birth to me. Mama fed me. Mama clothed me. Mama gave me everything I need. And then she's going to leave her baby? I'm going to offer a different perspective with our biblical text this morning. It's out of Acts chapter 1, verse 4. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised. You know, say promised. Which you have heard me speak about. But John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? He said, it is time for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority. Here's my favorite verse in Acts. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, Samaria, and all the ends of the earth. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I like Dr. Luke. Dr. Luke has something to say. He has this amazing way to put words together. But here's what I want you to be challenged with alongside of me. We've often said that the church in Pentecost has been birthed. And I don't disagree with that narrative, but I want to stretch your imagination this morning. Maybe it's a birth of a revolution. And we don't like revolutions because it means that we have to move out of our comfort. But I'm going to suggest that the Holy Spirit is coming to reset the earth, to reset the order of the day, to reconcile unity in the body of Christ by opening up heaven and allowed to come down to earth in just a little while. Jesus is coming to these disillusioned disciples. Anybody disillusioned today? But he says, I'll never leave nor forsake you. I have a question, Jesus. I'd be curious to know. How can you be in heaven and on earth at the same time. He's going to drop us a little hint. It's part of this Trinitarian language that he's going to drop the Holy Spirit down upon us, and when the Holy Spirit comes. But you gotta wait. You see, for nothing will be impossible with God. I have to remind myself of that often. Can I get an amen, somebody?
Amen.
Jesus is coming to seek and save the lost, mostly on the margins of society. Jesus actually never told us to build a monument. He never required membership. He doesn't talk about certificates or credentials. This Jesus is radical. This Jesus is a rebel. This Jesus talks about institutions. This Jesus has something to say to the government officials. This Jesus even has something to say to the folks in the temple. This Jesus spent more time around tables than he did in the temple. We spend more time in the temple than tables. This Jesus is hanging out all the time. And when he was in the temple, it didn't go well. So I'm going to suggest to my colleague, lay and clergy, that maybe every now and then, you need to sit at a table beyond your sacred spaces called the church. You see, Robert Harris, a Lucan scholar, writes, in Luke's gospel, Jesus is either going to a meal, at a meal, coming from a meal. What if we spent more time around tables teaching and sharing Christ with our neighbors? You see, this Jewish rabbi, who was not Christian, who never suggested Christianity as a way forward. Stay with me, I'm not done yet. This Jesus never used Christianity. This Jesus didn't call us to separate. This Jesus calls us to unite what was already going on. And so in the midst of understanding it, if we could spend some time around bulls, maybe just, maybe we need a table as opposed to a temple. You see, these disciples are caught up in a question. And Jesus is trying to get them to move forward. And they want to know, Lord, are you going to restore the kingdom? What? The United Methodist Church is asking, Lord, are you going to restore the United Methodist Church? Why would you want to restore something that wasn't working to begin with? You see, Jesus didn't come to restore anything. And restoring means that you go back to what it was. Lord, have mercy on us. You see, we need a crisis. Oh my goodness, God, we were in one. And the question remains for me, if we were in a crisis, coming out of the crisis, how different were we? We were trying to get back in the sanctuary when Jesus is trying to get us out of the sanctuary. So here's a question for you today. I got a lot of them. Who are you discipling? And who's discipling you? I'm not talking about Sunday morning worship. We don't disciple people on Sunday. That's a crowd. It's a gathering of folk. We proclaim the good news. We sing a few songs. Then we say, let's go to lunch. What if we practice discipleship and not programming? We don't need another curriculum. We need a sense of curiosity. What if we focus on discipleship, which includes social holiness and social justice? In our beloved church, you've made a decision. Either you're a social holiness church or you're a social justice church. Stop it. You're misbehaving. Jesus didn't tell us to separate. He's always calling us to unite and not divide. But maybe in the Jewish blessings, it says these words. As disciples were being discipled, not in a classroom setting, but following this rabbi as close as they could, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. What? You mean I should be preparing my messages in the marketplace? I was taught to go into the study, the sacred study, the holy desk, and start writing and hearing from the Lord. And I understand that, but I learned more in the marketplace with people as I'm sitting and discussing what is going on in your life. Jesus has a disruptive character, definitely. In the scriptures it says, whomsoever. He defies the marks of definition. He disrupts the norms of class. He pushes through the idea of race. He has a tendency to experience cultural humility, and he causes us to do the same thing. So when our churches decide to desegregate, the Lord said I wouldn't get any amens on that. What if we're asking the wrong questions? What if the church was a movement as opposed to a collection of monuments? I pray that this is so disruptive, that our annual conference is so disruptive, that we will end up having a revival by default. Yes. It's not what we expected. We expect to come here and sit on our, where is it? Blessed assurances. And go back to church like nothing happened. What if we shifted our mindset from monument building to practicing the rule of life? You see, no one grows in comfort. Yeah, let's talk about worship on Sunday. Let's talk about the order of worship. I've been challenged by that idea. How does something that originated in heaven, how do we construct an order to it? You see, I get to think freely because I'm a liberated person. I don't allow systems and people to hold me captive. I think at some point, the Methodist Church has to be set free from itself. What instead of asking just church questions, we needed to start asking community questions. How are you doing? What do you need? How can I walk and talk with you? You see, there's nothing wrong with church conferences. History. But what if we had community conferences that we sat around table with people we didn't know so that we would become the people who God has called us to be? John Wesley offers that the world is our parish. World is perishing. And we need a sense of urgency around this work. You see, the way, the people of the way that emerged from the continent of Africa and Asia is not this American Christianity that we have inherited. At some point, we have to deconstruct so that we can be reconstructed in a way that syncs us together, that we understand that we are the body of Christ and we belong together. You see, Jesus has invited these highly dysfunctional disciples to simply walk with him in his practices, his patterns, his philosophies. And what we've done to that thing is we said, oh no, we're going to rebrand this. And we want to know why we're in this persnickety moment and why we're not moving forward, because growth happens in unfamiliar and unexpected places. About 2 years ago, we're having worship in McKendree, and this young adult walks in with his grandmother. I noticed they were new because we always know when someone new comes into the community, and I ask our people, don't bum rush them. Please let them sit down. And after church, I walked up to him and I said, my name is Pastor Stephen. What is your name? He said, my name is Stephen. I said, oh, okay, how do you spell that? And he says, with a PH, like the one who was stoned. That's always my joke, y'all. And he says to me, I've been looking for a church that disciples people. Ooh. He says, because on your website, you said you make disciples for the transformation of the world. That's what your website says. He said, but I'm not looking for a church. I'm looking for a community. I don't need to be in another building. I'm looking for someone who wants to be authentic that I can walk with. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Not after church, please. And I say to him, let's do this. Let's grab a cup of coffee. 2 years, we've been drinking coffee every week. I want to invite you to stop inviting people to church. Now, before you have a heart attack, let me finish. Five cups of coffee. Please, invite somebody who you don't know to a cup of coffee so you can know them and get to know yourself. You see, I'm amazed. I just got a phone a couple of months ago, and it was in this Apple container. Now, whether you have an Apple or what is it called, an Android, it doesn't make a difference. So I pull it out, and it's all shiny, right? And I blow on it, and I rub it, and I look at it, and it has all of this information in it, but it's deactivated. Church has all of this stuff. All of these things that God has prepared us to do. And sometimes, if we're not careful, we will deactivate the Spirit of God. And so I'm sitting there, and I said, I had to go to somebody. I had to go to somebody to get it activated because I'm not smart enough, spiritual enough, to activate it myself. So I had to go to someone who's in charge of activation. God is in charge of activation. You can't activate yourself. We're not that smart nor that spiritual. But here's what I know. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and my favorite, self-control. You see, God did not call us into this atmosphere of membership. There's not any word in the Greek that translates to membership. But we have a church that's predicated on membership. What if we were predicated on apprenticeship? You see, Jesus was an apprentice, and the challenge with us today is we teach everything in the bounds of a wall or a classroom. I want to invite you from this day forward to shut it all down. Well, don't do that. That's not a good idea. But in addition to that, at this annual conference, befriend someone who doesn't look like you, dress like you, have your skin pigmentation, have your hair texture, and hang out with them for the next 2.5 days, unafraid of what you may say or what you may hear. But then Jesus said, but you will. But is a wonderful word. I love it because it erases everything that said before it. Had a conversation with my wife just a couple days ago. And I said, you know, I love you. But I got some issues. Because the church has issues. Instead of being a people-focused church, we've become an issues-focused church. And so Jesus is saying you will respond to win. Nobody gets to determine the win, so sit and behave until the Spirit spirits. So he says, now stay in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is a place of comfort. It's homeland. It's where There's common interest and common language. Watch this now. Common values, common mindset, common interpretation, common theological perspectives. It's a safe place. It's where we go on Sunday. It's safe. Because we know people's names. And then in verse 1 of chapter 8, and Saul approved of their killing him. That day, a severe persecution began against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered. What if we would reclaim scattering as opposed to settling? I'm convinced that the church in America is predicated on settlement. We build buildings, and we settle. We set times for people to come and settle with us. We have programs that settle us. When in the biblical text, it's not mine, I didn't write it, I wouldn't have written it this way. It said that they were scattered. When was the last time we were scattered as a church? What if we would reclaim scattering as opposed to settling as a core value? C.S. Lewis, theologian and writer, has this quote in his Requiem. A familiar capacity is frequently more desirable than an unfamiliar freedom. Can I say dang? You see, as Methodists, we were a people who were unfamiliar in captivity, in places where God has called us. But Jesus is inviting us to reclaim that scattering. And then he says, let's go to Judea. Judea is this place that is more challenging and engaging to our understanding of what it means to be part of humanity. It's where we have to check our privilege. I know you all don't hear that word much, and it doesn't feel good. Check your privilege. Check what you think you know, and every now and then, you've been formed to listen twice as much as you speak. So stop speaking twice as much as we listen. You see, Jesus is calling us to be a people of connection. Not a church where we leave people behind over biblical interpretation and doctrine. Then he says, go to Judea, which is more challenging to share the gospel. It's where people don't really know you and you don't know them. And then he says, well, let's go to Samaria. I love Samaria. Samaria were the biracial folk. Triracial. And here's what I've learned about the church. If you create a group of people with sameness, it's called boring. What would happen if starting today we would pray that our churches would be diverse in class, in race, in theological perspective, on purpose? And what if every Sunday we challenge our church to have more people, more diverse people, more young people? You see, Samaria is this wonderful place that are considered enemy territory. Maybe around your church, there's some enemy territory. If you live in Brentwood, Bardell is enemy territory. If you live in Murfreesboro, I don't know what the enemy is, but I'm sure there's some enemies in Murfreesboro. Every place has a place where they dare not go because they are scared. What would happen if we gave fear to God and said, give us more faith? You see, at the end of the day, convinced more than ever that this is not about our comfort, this is more about our courage and capacity to ask what if should. So travel with your companion called curiosity. Remember, no one grows in comfort. Reclaim scattering as opposed to settling. How will the state considered Western Kentucky and Tennessee know and love Christ if we don't tell somebody? The spirit that upon us, Lord have mercy, I'm getting ready to go there now. The spirit of God is upon us because he has anointed us to proclaim the good news to the poor. Don't judge people. He said, share it anyway. He sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoners. While we're sitting here right now, some people in prison by the trauma that they have received by the church. Recovery of sight to the blind. Although you may be able to see, sometimes we are spiritually blind. And my last one, to set the oppressed free. What would happen if you had the audacity to leave annual conference and say no more of what we know, we're living into the unknown? What if you decided this day that you would partner with people who everybody dislikes? What if we were to partner with folk who don't have enough insurance? What if we partner with people who are making minimum wage? What if we partner with people who did not have enough housing and clothing? You see, the beauty of the church is that we see differently. And I invited you to have a cup of coffee with me. I want to get to know you for who you are, because to follow Jesus means to be with Jesus, to become like Jesus, to belong like Jesus. Are you ready to transform the world the way Christ has called us to? Are you ready to get off of your Humpty Dumpties and move forward into a world that says, if it's not for you, I don't know what I would have done? Are you ready to see differently, to change your set of lens, to get a new prescription? Are you ready to befriend folk that you never thought you would have a conversation with? Are you ready? Are you ready to follow a Jewish rabbi who sets the world on fire? Are you ready to stop being content in what you know and live into the unknown? Are you ready to stop being what you used to be and grow into what God has called you to be? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready to proclaim good news even in bad news situations?
Amen.
Are you ready? Are you ready? This is our time. I'm under God. This is the day of the Lord. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hear the words of wisdom. Say these with me. The words of wisdom, also known as the wow, you have the slide. I saw it this morning. Scripture says, wait on the Lord. Say this with me. What if we use
God's power?
Say it again.
What if we use God's power to change the world?
Say it like you mean it.
What if we use God's power to change the world?
In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Greetings, holy, healthy, and happy people of God. It is a joy to see you and to be seen by you. The Duck River Charge, I pray for you all often. I pray for all of the 20 churches in the urban cohort. But here's what I want to tell you. We are 99.1% the same. We're 99.1% the same. We are 99.1% the same. The only difference is around our hair texture, our eye color, and our skin pigmentation. That's it. If we're 99.1% the same, don't you think we belong together?
Amen.
And so I invite you to explore what that means in this season. Church is evolving, and it needs to. Amen?
Amen.
So I want to journey with you. I tell Jim and I met with Jane how beautiful this journey is for me, because I got this issue that I'm processing. I love people. I love all kinds of people. I like different people. The world would be really boring if I married myself. So if you're married, imagine marrying yourself. Oh my goodness, right? If you're dating, imagine dating yourself. So I want to just open up the floor, and it was hard for me to watch myself. I've actually never watched that before, because I don't like watching myself preach. I mean, I was the sixth grader when they did recordings, and my voice was changing. It hadn't changed, it was transitioning. And they hit this tape recorder. Anybody remember tape recorder?
Yeah.
The tape recorder, and I heard my voice, and I dropped my head, and they go, "That's not me." And they said, "Yeah, that's you." So we are in this generation called Generation T. I never knew it existed. Generation T is a generation of transformation. How many of us in this room have not experienced transformation in this season of our lives, right? So grateful that I'm able to journey with you. Just know I love people. And I invite you to a cup of coffee. I don't have the budget for it, but we'll figure it out. Thank you, Jim, for the invitation. I don't know how much time we have, but let's just take a few moments. What did you think about what you heard? Just raise your hand. I want to hear your voice. What did you think about what you heard this morning? Don't be shy. I've been known to choose people because I love people, so I might point you out if you don't point yourself out. So what did you think? Just one word. One word.
I'm fine.
Can I ask you why? It's okay. Take your time.
I know that I got my confidence on a lot, but I know I need to be out more.
Yeah.
And I know that I need to do more. And so it makes me uncomfortable.
Yes.
So it makes me feel that others are so important. And we so often say, "Oh, well, I don't like their hair or your tattoo or your nose ring or whatever it is," and they've got the same, same junk we have.
Right.
And so.
Yeah. Thank you for your vulnerability. Anyone else?
I love you.
Thank you. Why?
Because of a strong message.
Absolutely. Okay.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Truth and necessary.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Long overdue.
Yes.
I would say living example right here.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Your voices are important. You do have something to say. So say it. In the midst of the house of the Lord. The Lord knows, but I don't, so I want to hear it.
Get out of your comfort zone if I can do it.
Yeah.
I think it's exciting.
Yes.
We have a great direction that we're called to. Mm-hmm. We don't have to wonder. He gave it to us.
No. So I tell people, we spent a great deal of time trying to figure it out. Jesus never called us to figure it out. If you have children, it's problematic trying to figure them out. Your parents tried to figure you out. We're called to simply have faith. That's a shift for me, because I'm a fixer. If you're a man, you fix things. And sometimes my wife says, "I didn't ask you to fix anything. I just need you to listen." Can I get an amen, ladies?
Amen.
I knew I was going to get an amen out of that. So any questions of me? I love answering questions, but I ask you, love asking questions. I invite people to live into the question of this moment in our history as Americans. What does the kingdom of God look like? Not my question, it's a Jesus question. What does the kingdom of God look like? And where is the evidence when you see it, and how do you share it? So I'm grateful that this charge is, understand, I'm an illustrator. So can I get four people real quick? Just four. Just four people. Four people from each one of the churches. I want a representative from each one of the churches. Okay. So I get three more representatives.
Oh, come on, guys.
I need three more representatives. Okay, now I need two. I need two more. I need one more representative. One more. Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you for your diversity on purpose. Thank you for your diversity. Okay. So I want you to stay right here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I don't want you right here. Is this live?
Yes,
yes it is.
Oh, yes. Lord. I want you right here. And I don't want you right here. Now imagine each one of these churches doing their own thing on their own time. Isolated. Now imagine if the leadership, so go, I'm not get you all to hold hands. I know that's pretty. So imagine now leadership training, leadership development, all four. Because each one of these represents a community and not a location.
Amen.
It's been instilled in us that when we send a pastor to a church, I talked to our bishop a couple of years ago. Oh, this is recorded.
Uh-oh. Go for it.
And I said to him, stop sending pastors to churches. Yeah, he looked at me just like that. I got that one. That was straight up. And I said, we're sent to communities. We're not sent to churches. We may work out of a church, but we're sent to communities. These four churches represent four communities that are integrated so that the kingdom of God will be evident.
Amen.
So what you don't get to do is settle in your church. Yes. You don't get to do that. It's not an option. So my first day at McKendree, I stop at a stoplight, and on my right side, there's a man eating out of a garbage can. I'm going, oh, I'm at the wrong location. So I drive up to the church. I get out of the church. I literally walk over three people to get in the front door. I wasn't raised that way. I'm a middle-class kid. God shocked me that day. And I realized that today, 30% of our congregation are unhoused people. They don't have anywhere to live, they don't have anywhere to eat, they don't have any clothing. So we designed this transitional housing facility in our basement. We house up to eight men, 24/7, 365, and we give them affordable housing with Metro government. So we put 18 men in housing. It's not a big number. But there are 18 men who are in housing because they stayed in our facility for 90 days. You all are doing some good work. Multiply it. These four brains, right? Four? Can I get four? Four brains? Maybe. Score the gas, right? These four brains times equals limited possibilities. So have more coffee. More of this work is needed because people are watching us. Caleb, what's Caleb? Caleb is watching everything we do. He may not articulate it while he's eating his apple. My children use some language that I wonder where they got it from. And I realize they got it from me because I was using it. So my brothers and sisters, this is our time. I'm so committed to more being like Jesus than ever in my life. And I thank God for that. Because I need you to be you. I need me to be me. I need us to be us for the glory of God. Y'all with me?
Woo! Yes.
Let's get this party started. okay. It's our time. These walls are simply temporary. They're needed to teach us, but there's more teaching that happens in the marketplace than the temple. Have a seat. Thank you very much. So I made this comment, and I'm gonna go to my grave with it. There are more people in coffee shops on Sunday than in churches. I want you to think about that. There are more people in coffee shops on Sunday than in churches. 30 years ago, that never would have been said, because the coffee shops would have not have been open because of the blue laws. Anybody remember blue laws? I don't have that kind of authority, so if I could, I might, but I'm not sure. Any questions of me? Here's my professor when I worked on my D-Man at Wesley Seminary in D.C. He says, great leaders don't have great answers. Great leaders ask great questions. Thank you for nodding, at least two nods. And I'm not going to forget that face when I said, church, you know. Well, you're beloved. I'm grateful for you. And Jim knows if you need me, I'll make myself available, because I'm here to serve the people and not be served. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Maybe you can understand a little bit about where I get some of my excitement and some of my passion. Stephen is a great mentor, a great leader, and is always available. But he said something that we need to remember. We can't be the church if we're in the church. And I think it's important for us to remember that. And I'm going to challenge you. Janetta and I have spoke, I've run it by Stephen. We are going to go into some uncomfortable places. We're going to go where some people are not used to seeing the face of Jesus. Mm-hmm. We're going to go into places that live long and prosper, boldly go where no one has gone before. But I need your help. I need your help. So just be prepared, because you're going to be challenged, and it may not feel good for a while, but that's okay. Because when Jesus went back into Judea, when he even went back into Nazareth, where his own people threw him out, I don't think he felt comfortable, but he needed to be there. I invite you to stand as you're able, as we join together, and I want you to listen to this. I want you to say these words like you mean them. Here I am, Lord.
My hand will say.
close with our tradition of the peace prayer of St. Francis of Assisi. Once again, after that message from Stephen, if you don't get the message, come and see me. Lord,
make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me so love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
For our benediction, I'm going to ask a blessing for our meal. So would you pray with me? Almighty God, as we part from here, let us actually be your church. Let us be your example. And remember that our job is to tell people. Your job is to save them. Now be with us. The food that we're about to receive, may it strengthen us so that we can face the struggles of taking the church, of taking the example of Christ into places that are very uncomfortable and very dark. May you strengthen us, guide us, and protect us now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
I sent out a letter with a statement of the church. Sent it via email. If you did not receive that, there are hard copies back on the table. Don't forget this afternoon at 4 o'clock if you want to join us at First Methodist in Franklin. And don't forget that on Wednesday night at Recharge Wednesday, we're going to be exploring different options for the Bible study of the chosen. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you so much. Go in peace.
We got coffee on.